1865, the House of Assembly in St. John's adopted a resolution that would, in effect, start the construction of the Newfoundland Railway. In the 1880s, however, the rattle of the rail coaches and the constant belch of black smoke was a familiar sight only to the residents of the Avalon Peninsula. Construction on the railway began again in 1889, with tenders called for the construction of the rail line to Halls Bay, and a contractor by the name of R.G. Reed entered the stage of the Newfoundland Railway. In 1898, finally, the rail line was completed from St. John's to Port-au-Basque, and on June the 29th in that year, the first train left St. John's for Port-au-Basque. It left at 7 p.m. and contained two baggage cars, one day coach, one dining car, and two sleeping cars. Took 27 hours and 45 minutes. On July the 2nd, 1969, Newfoundland's famous coast-to-coast passenger train left Port-au-Basque for the last time, departing 10 a.m. with about 350 passengers. People turned out all along the 547-mile route to wave goodbye. And according to the Evening Telegram on July the 3rd, 1969, quote, at Bishop Falls, begging for placemats, menus, and anything else that wasn't nailed down for souvenirs. Even as night fell, there were cars parked anywhere the highway intersected the railway track, and drivers tooted their horns in salute. End of quote. The Newfie Bullet had indeed achieved fame, but was to be no more. It carried on, though, in another form for some 20 years, and now, on this September 3rd, train winds its way across the province. And once this trip is completed, the rails will be taken up, and this part of the history of the province of Newfoundland and Labrador will cease to exist. It is indeed our pleasure to bring you this video to take you on the final trip from Bishop Falls.
Thank you. sir.
And we're entering Grand Falls, Windsor. Seems to be quite a number of people out to see the last train.
I'd do very much if the train will stop here, will I? Because they tow the carriers and the bishops. So I would say the train will just slow down going through Banfal and stop at Badger. Any passengers that came here have probably gone on to Badger to get on. Either the bus load of school kids getting off at Badger.
Of course, now the community of Windsor has seen a lot of changes, Mont, since the history of the railways come in. Certainly a lot of changes in the whole area of Grand Falls and Windsor.
Right now, it's one of the few stations that are working between Grand Falls and Fort Bass. There's nothing, just a little bit of activity in Bishop's Falls, certainly, that's where the terminal starts. But after you leave Grand Falls, there's no manned station after you get the carnival.
So all of the people that used to work here at one time, they've been gone ever since, I guess, 69 passenger train.
The most activity around here now is the boat cruiser service, and this way you buy tickets for east or west from here. Very little activity except a few container carriers that are dropped out here for something like that.
So I guess Grand Falls and as such wouldn't be considered at this day in 1988 as much, say, of a railway town as Bishop Falls or some of the other places we'll see along this route.
No, Bishop Falls is really the center terminal in the province. It's divided up into four terminals. You've got St. John's to Farnville, and then Farnville to Bishop Falls. Bishop Falls to Carnival, and Carnival to Fort Bass. So a lot of railroaders were born and lived in Bishop Falls because they worked from Bishop Falls east or Bishop Falls west. Whereas Grand Falls was just a station at one time where freight was picked up or passengers were picked up or dropped off. But crews, all the train crews, were rigid.
So the sentimentality that we've seen with the crew in Bishop Falls certainly wouldn't be the same in Grand Falls.
No, certainly not. Most of the employees in Grand Falls would be ticket agents and freight handlers and that sort of thing.
Okay, well, we'll pick up again as we come into Badger. And what are you anticipating to see in Badger?
In Badger, there's a lot of railroaders in Badger. A lot of the section men and that sort of info in Badger who work at the railway. And that's the home of what they call the weight fleet, which is the work crew, the track crew. So there should be a lot of railroaders out to see the train there. And certainly the school bus will be there to pick up the pupils from Lewisport are on the train now. And I imagine there'll be some passengers getting on there when the kids get out and make room. Thank you. Junction was a fairly busy railroad town. In 1901, I believe, the railway was extended from the main line here in Millertown Junction to Millertown, and then in the 30s, on the Buckhams. And certainly all the ore was hauled from Buckhams down to here, and then from here by Newfoundland Railway and later to CN, down to Bishop's Falls or Grand Falls, and then on to Botwood. Also, because there was no road system west of Badger, the only way into the A&D Company woods camps in the Millertown area was by train. So all the loggers had to come to Millertown Junction and get off train run by Sarko into the woods camps. So it was a very, very busy place. I've heard people say here they've seen as many as 600 to 700 people getting on and off trains at one time. In fact, there were times when they had to run special passenger trains from Bishop's Falls up here to pick up the loggers when they would close the woods camps in the spring and so on.
In late February 1903, when an express train was held up for 17 days in the Kittysbrook and Gaftopfel's area, due east of Deer Lake. It must have encountered heavy drifts well before that, as many passengers had already disembarked further east and walked to nearby settlements. W.H. Coombs of Brig Bay, on the west coast, for instance, had had enough at Millertown Junction and decided to walk home. It took him about 2 weeks to travel the 250 miles, and when he got home, the train was still stuck, not too many miles from where he left it. Snow fell from -3 to -23 degrees Fahrenheit. In one cut, the snow was 23 feet deep. The frost is so severe, claimed one newspaper of the time, that no one gang of men can be kept long at work for the fear of being frostbitten. Another newspaper provided a different report. The laborers were offered as much as 30 cents an hour, but not enough of them could be mustered to do any appreciable work. Even the section men preferred to give up their jobs rather than work.
Certainly to keep the trains going later, I believe, probably in the 30s or 40s, they brought in what they called a rotary plow, which was a plow with a wheel, probably about a 14-foot wheel on the front, which would throw the snow away from the track. But actually what it would do, it would be cut a trench through the snow, so when the winds came up again, the track would just drift in again and was just a continual fight all winter.
One thing for sure in this area, the elevation combined with the barrenness of the land certainly makes for a very bleak appearance. There's hardly a tree, there's very little shelter, and it must be really, really cold here in the wintertime.
Well, it's certainly cold, and certainly you can very seldom see any more than a pole length, you know, and you certainly would never travel by foot or from the main line here. If you did, you'd be lost in no time, you know.
We've picked up a couple of passengers along the route, one at Summit, I think it was, and others as we go through, and this seems to be the custom. There's a lot of cabins here, and the railway certainly is going to be missed in this area by the people who have these cabins.
Yeah, several people have cabins up here. There's some at Quarry, and some at Summit, and some at Gartopsels, and then when we get down to Pine Crossing, you'll see there's came up here to pick berries and to hunt birds and to hunt caribou, hunt moose, mostly outdoor people, woodsmen, that sort of thing. A hunter's paradise, really, this area.
Yeah, so there must be, as you go inland from the railway track, there must be several herds of caribou. We've seen a couple of individual ones on the trip across now, but there must be some herds in back for sure.
Topsail area here, which you can see fairly soon, that's the breeding ground of caribou, and there's no trouble in the fall of the year or in the winter if you went in on skidoo to see 200 or 300 caribou at one time. It's really a beautiful place, a barren place, and certainly the only access to it is by railway.
So now once these levees and this sort of thing will be the only access that will be for the people who own the cabins up here?
I suppose so. There's a rumor going around that the CN, when they take up the tracks, will bulldoze or grade the roadbed and probably make it accessible by pickups or four-wheel drives at least. And if not, then the only access would be by all-terrain vehicles.
make sure you put your name down right.
You thought they'd finish that sending glass.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
Yes, no sense.
I thought he should be a little bit higher on
it. He's got it right on tape.
Yeah, well, no, make sure you don't ask me something I can't answer.
So, this is Pat O'Reilly, chief engineer, are you?
I suppose you're not. Chief.
Pat, how long have you been working with the railway now?
Well, I came on back in the 50s, 1953, and you know, I sat down with over 35 years now today.
Well, I guess you've got a lot of mixed feelings with the railway, well, you know, have you?
Well, the most of my mixed feelings would be not for myself personally, because I'm an enjoy like 54, I'm old, but it's a younger man that's on the job, still at home, practically not even.
Do you feel the lost something while closing up the railway to Newfoundland?
Something that most all the landers would care before I'm born, so I bet you have a visit, you know, because if your children were born after you came around, the railroad was here, and that would have taken away from us, you know, so easy.
So you see the Newfoundland,
well, something missing, it was something, you know, that's hard to do it, because that was
so what are you going to do now?
Well, this is my
pension age, or?
Yes, I've got 1 year to go. I've a horrible money out in it. I had thought I'd become 55, but now this is a bigger opportunity. You're going to give me a little more out of the home. And I'm 13 years old, and they didn't offer any more than the name. I got caught with the CBC.
So for you, it's not too bad.
No, and I'm going to
be very in
my pension age. And the friends of mine, I would say, nobody should work after your name. I'm going to enjoy like you.
How have you enjoyed your career over the years?
Well, this career for me, I would say, was the best thing that happened to me than any man. It's such a healthy job, you know, it's a control for what's going on. There's not too much pressure on you. Most of the time, you can say, you know, the same thing day after day. Nobody has your back up. It's okay to go, sir.
Hi, Bob.
Yeah, the one is, I wouldn't want anything else to like it, but I was.
So this day to you will certainly have a great degree of nostalgia. You look back at this with your family and
shock. No trouble to look at that video tape. There's no much trouble to buy a tape or something.
Right.
But I really must say that I was contented and happy, and no matter if I got called 10 o'clock tonight or 4 o'clock tomorrow.
Yeah.
I always went to work.
When did you actually start working? Back a long time.
Yeah.
Oh, back then.
Thank you.
side the track all the time.
That's it. That's the only way. You know? So what's this? You're going back down now.
Yeah.
How long have you been up here?
I've been up a month. Six or seven years.
Yeah. Well, let me help you in that.
We're gonna fight for it.
Yeah, sure.
If we get something, they'll help us out, I guess.
Sure.
They'll help us out.
A lot of people are moving all their things down the way.
All you see running around, you mean movie cameras.
Yeah.
See that one there right here? That's our it's our wreath there, look. Our counter's on the other side.
I don't know if you don't care anymore. Now I can hear you again. I don't know. I don't know. I don't know.
Amazing to see the number of people who just got on this train from Pond Crossing, and even more so than the people, the belongings and the signs indicate that they're not too happy with the closing of the railway, and I thought it very significant that the wreath was laid by the people to commemorate this very sad day in their lives.
Well, it's a sad day for sure for the people here at Pond Crossing. Most of the people here will be from Dearly, and the cabins are small, but they come out here pretty regularly. Some of them come out and spend a month, especially when people go here. And you can see some of them probably go back to the 30 or 40 gallon park. That's been the tradition for years.
Thank you.
area behind us, the ruggedness, the barrenness of the area, very few trees, and now coming into Deer Lake and the Humber Valley, certainly a contrast between the gap tops of the area.
Yes, well, the Humber Valley, certainly there are a number of farms down to the Humber Valley, a beautiful area. As we get down a little bit further, you'll see the mountains on both sides just before we get into Cornbrook. And you'll notice then that the track and the road, the high road, run side by side and just cling to the side of the cliff.
Well, certainly it's a vast province, and one that's been, if it were not for the railway, I guess we wouldn't be into the interior of the province. And yet, as we pass by the transport trucks, we see that the road is going to be the main mode of transportation, and the big transport trucks are going to take the place of the railway line. And I suppose that's inevitable. That's part of the future.
Well, it seems the way it's going, I guess a lot of the freight will come directly by boat into St. John's and will be transported by the heavy trucks with containers. I guess that's the way it'll be.
Okay, it's been a very enjoyable trip and part of history, but yet a beautiful experience.
I certainly enjoyed it today, Roy, and very soon I'll be coming into Cornbrook, which will be the end of our trip, and certainly the crews will have an hour or two rest, and then we'll be heading back to Bishop's Off, Ron, which we won't be filming, of course, because it'll be dark, but when the train arrives in Bishop's Off tonight, then we can say that was the final lap of the final trip.
Well, you can wait by the railroad track, won't be no trains coming and going. You can wait, but they won't be back, won't be no trains coming and going. Well, they took apart that band of steel down in the wrecker's yard, and they left me standing here dragging my heels. Times get tough and times get hard. Well, you can wait by the railroad track, won't be no trains coming and going. You can wait, but they won't be back, won't be no trains coming and going. And you won't see the lights in the passenger cars, pictures in the window frames. And you won't hear them shouting out all aboard, last call for the St. John train. Well, you can wait by the railroad track, won't be no trains coming and going. You can wait, but they won't be back, won't be no trains coming.